Here at the International Myeloma Workshop in Boston this morning, we had a session on toxicities of treatments for multiple myeloma. In this session, we reviewed all the drugs that we use for patients with multiple myeloma and went over some of the common toxicities and their management. A lot of these drugs, at least the drug classes, have been around for a while, but as time goes by, we learn more about the toxicity profiles of these drugs. The immunomodulatory drugs, we have lenalidomide, thalidomide, and pomalidomide. We talked about the hematological toxicity of the drugs and the need to give drugs and not stop treatment, especially in very refractory patients, and if need be, support with growth factors. We talked about with these drugs that there is certainly a difference in the neuropathy profile of these drugs, but also that the fatigue and to some extent in some patients cognitive impairments are also being noted, and that is an area that hasn't been studied well and may be worthy of further study in prospective trials. We reviewed the drugs of the proteasome inhibitor class with bortezomib. We've been well aware of its neurological toxicity. With carfilzomib, we're aware of the cardiopulmonary issues. We even talked about the fact that the pathogenic mechanism of the cardiopulmonary toxicity is not well delineated. It may be an endovascular injury pattern because the spectrum includes not only some patients' deficits in cardiac contractility, but others have just a capillary leak syndrome. Some have renal insufficiency as part of their presentation in terms of toxicity, hypertension. So this kind of may have a common underlying pathogenesis. With the monoclonal antibodies, we're all aware that they're relatively safe, but infusion reactions are the main thing that one has to look out for. And we are getting better at managing the infusion reactions. With daratumumab, now off-label, we usually tend to give singular, especially with the first dose. And this may be something that may become moot if daratumumab becomes available subcutaneous in the next several months. That would further improve that aspect of things. Then we talked about the GI toxicities of two other agents that we have approved for myeloma. One is panobinostat, a drug that's not very commonly used, but perhaps underused, we said. And we talked about how to manage the diarrhea in these patients. But also, we had a segment that we devoted towards the management of the toxicities of selinexor, which was just approved about a month ago. This is a drug that has proven effective in patients who are very refractory to all available treatments, with about a fourth of patients responding. But what we have seen in our experience is gastrointestinal toxicity, not only nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, but also in some patients profound weight loss due to loss of appetite. So we discussed what experience investigators on studies have had, and we said that proactive measures to counteract these GI toxicities are most important. Following the protocol that was developed at Mount Sinai, which has treated a lot of these patients, we advocated for the use of prophylactic anti-nausea medicines, not only 5-HT3 blockers, but also either olanzapine or an NK1 antagonist. And this is something that some patients may need all three. We talked about the need for preventative measures for appetite in terms of using drugs like dronabinol. We also talked about the fact that these patients need to be aggressively treated should they develop diarrhea. These patients have to be brought in at the beginning, at least for the first cycle or two, perhaps once or twice a week, to get them IV fluids, so that one has a little bit of an idea about how they are tolerating the drug. Close observation is very necessary. Selinexor crosses the blood-brain barrier, which is a positive because it may actually help the rare cases of CNS involvement by myeloma that we see, but also the fact is that This is a drug that can cause fatigue, perhaps for the same reason. So uses of some patients Ritalin or other psychomimetics may be necessary. And I think that this is a drug that if one can deliver, it is likely to be efficacious in a highly refractory population. But prophylactic measures are necessary. One of the other things we talked about off-label is that though the drug is approved for administration in a twice-weekly manner, giving a once-weekly dose with bortezomib, which is part of the Boston study, may be a better way if one can get the approval through insurance, because that leads to cumulative less exposure to the drug and perhaps lower toxicity.